Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Let's Play Hearts of Iron 4, the North America. Let's continue on from where we last left off. So, we are currently stacking the bench. We have killed Jim. We have not killed Jim Crow. We have killed the Civil Rights Act. Again, I'm not too sure how exactly they were able to do it. Like, I guess with the presidential executive order would be my guess. Again, Thurman doesn't have the votes to do anything. But we'll see. Popularities. Presumably the Marxist caucus is getting, a little bit more support. I mean, it's still very, very low. Very, very low, middling, high. It's so funny how unpopular the nationalists are. Like, it's kind of crazy. They keep on doing more operations in Europe. Just for the idea, maybe that Iberia would like to join us. You know? I would like them to. I'd like to be their best friend. But unfortunately, we can't all get what we want. Because they're still... Are they still dealing with the oil crisis? Presumably... Not... Oh, no, wait, no. Not going through a crisis. Okay, it's worded a little bit weirdly there, but I think it, I think it means that they're done the oil crisis as best as they can be. RDC runs a respectful campaign. The question... Questioning the dream. The poor man drives home from his daily grind at the auto factory. His next payday is weeks away, and he wonders if he'll be able to eat until then. He questions why he can barely afford the necessities while his rude, lazy supervisor owns a second car and a vacation home in Florida. Commiserating his lot in life, he turns on the radio. Another man speaks, his voice loud and commanding. He decries the state of America that squeezes the workers dry while funneling his wealth towards the upper classes. He calls for the wealth to belong to the people and return to the people. The poor man listens to his words intensely, all the way back home. A university student pours over her essay on American history, knowing that her professor will scold her for how unpatriotic it is. As a girl, she's believed that her nation was the greatest in the world. But they're reading what scarce a few books she can find about the history of Native genocide and the Red Scare and the legacy of Jim Crow, she found it hard to feel any sense of pride anymore. She spies a leaflet pinned to a corkboard on the wall. It advertises a student activist group claiming to preach the real sordid history of America. After some musing, she sets off to attend its first meeting. The black man has been politely turned away from some offices, or actively laughed out of others. Finally, he finds someone who will take him seriously. The white man greets him warmly and asks him about his previous experience. He talks about his days as a lawyer, primarily defending civil rights activists and the poor and the downtrodden, and the official listens to him patiently. After a lengthy interview, both are smiling. The Marxists are coming into the light, and the black lawyer and defender of civil rights is exactly the type of person they like to put on the ballot. Something is a change in America. The ideal of an American dream no longer holds the luster that it once did, and anger is beginning to mount. Decades of broken promises are finally catching up to the country, and unless something changes, the people may well turn to the ideas once considered anathema. The system begins to crack. So more and more people in America seem like they are going to be siding with the communists. But again, like, it's we're in this, like, weird state where the progressives are still really, really, really popular. Like, you're at 35%. You're at 4.9. I'm guessing the events are boosting these one way or the other. We're just not able to actually see what the numbers are. Necessary precautions. The stakes thought President Thurman were too high to lead the risk as far as the law was concerned. In these difficult times, he needed judges who would see things from his point of view. Officially, this was within his power to make sure of, but the precedent, well, was a dangerous matter. Getting enough justices on the Supreme Court bench would require one of two possibilities. Either enough seats were given up, or he would make new seats to fill them. Freeing up seats would naturally require that those currently occupying the seats vacate them, and making sure that they would be willing to retire so early would require that some underhand attacks indeed. On the other hand, packing the court was an equally unscrupulous and far more overt measure that was certain to kick the American hornet's nest even harder. Yet, at this point, it hardly mattered. He had already come this far, and the restoration of American values were so close at hand. Let's make more seats. Let's stack the court. Mostly because I think this is the most likely that's going to backfire against Thurmond. But at the same time, it seems like something he would do. That he would want to that he would want to try to back this. Because, like, we can cut this down to zero. I don't think we're going to need more than $140 million or $120 million, $140 million, whatever the number was. I don't think we're going to need more money than that at any time going into this in the future. That would at least be my guess. Redraw the map. So which one are you? All reasonable men know that the Civil Rights Act is a travesty among American sensibilities. It's not a shame, then, that much of the MPP are not reasonable men. No matter the sacrifice, we have to ensure that our pact remains united. To repeal it immediately would be a blow to our unity. Okay. The sender shall not hold. Is this banning the Civil Rights Act? The Ghost of Jim Crow. Jim Crow's Eulogy. Interesting. The Emergency Judicial Powers Act. The current political environment of America has become unsustainably toxic, and the rule of law is under threat, explained John McClellan to the assembled senators. In the interest of national security, we propose measures for the addition of 4 seats to the Supreme Court of the United States of America. Almost immediately, the Senate floor descended into chaos. The Democrats in particular were furious, calling it an unforgivable and blatant act of tyranny. And the floor was not silent for several hours, as insults and accusations were traded between the parties and even within them. On the other hand, Republicans were notably ambivalent on the matter, and their apparent lack of scruples with the bill did not escape President Thurman's eyes. While the MPP is in lockstep behind his bull rush at the finish, Republican support could be key. Even some heavy-handed tactics, support for the bill in the Senate is low enough that without the support of the Republicans, it's unlikely to pass. Getting them on board would be crucial for passing the bill, at least through the usual means. As for the Constitution, the president has the power to force a bill through with an executive order. However, given the current situation in American politics and its frequent description as a powder keg, using such a forceful measure at this time could prove dire. Sign an executive order, or let's see, the Republicans will support us. Let's see if they'll work with Republicans. I think it makes sense that the Nationalists would, in this circumstance, try to bolster some sort of deal with Republicans. The conclusion of the Turkians. Tragedy struck the Central Asia following a series of assassinations. Okay, I think people are saying that this is like the final... The final world event that we're really going to have to deal with here. Is Central Asia blowing up. And we'll see what we can kind of get done there. We're now going to lose 8 seats. The RDC is actually going to fucking dominate the coming election. It's actually kind of crazy. Oh no, we're already campaigning. The poll's updated. We didn't. Our campaign is the same. This is really, really, really bad for the NPP. They had a great 4 years under Kennedy, but we'll see. Deal with the devils. A few backroom meetings later and some degree of understanding was reached between the Thurmond clique and the Democrats. While not entirely convinced that the bill was, and somewhat nervous about the implications, various Democrats expressed a willingness to get in bed with Thurmond in exchange for a few riders being added to the bill. They expressed tepid support for the push for conservative values, though they desired a means of cushioning the blow to their reputation from supporting dubious moral actions. Namely, they desired the inclusion of support for their home states in the form of increased benefits for the unemployment and more state pensions. For such a reasonable price, though perhaps a touch of a place on a security bill, the Democrat support can all be but secured. Of course, it's not certain that this will be enough. Republicans are all but certain to vote unanimously against the bill, and though the pact has corralled in... Why are the Republicans vote against it? Is this an old event from before? I think this is an old event. The Million Man March... Sure, let's get low pensions and low subsidies. Because it said it works with the Republicans, and that event said Democrats. So I think that's just an event that was not updated properly. That makes the most sense to me. Operational success. Again, we'll just contribute more money to the Iberians. Like, that seems fine. And I think we're not going to kill the civil rights. We're going to... The center must hold. Because, again, the Nationalists don't have the support. Also, you can... read this if you want. The Million Man March. Somehow, just as when it seemed things could not get any worse, they very suddenly and yet so predictably did. As the news of the President Thormund forcing through his court-packing antics swept the nation, what was once a barely containable inferno was now doused with jet fuel. The cry went up and down the country, a cry of fear and fury, a cry that the government had been fully compromised by forces that sought to drag America backwards and to subvert the rights and liberties of all its citizens. The struggle against the nationalists was no longer for the rights of the black man or for one man's legacy, but for the very soul of American democracy itself. And the people answered that call. They came in their hundreds of thousands. They came. In any attempt to fortify Washington against the onslaught was borderline futile. The crowd swamped the National Mall, surrounded the Capitol and the White House, and occupied large portions of the remainder of the city. They marched, they kicked, they screamed in revulsion, disgust at what their government had become. The same people who less than 4 years ago hence had voted for the government of hope and equality now stood arm in arm against the government's corruption corpse. Amidst the din and against smatterings of counter-demonstrators, the ideologues raged. Gus Hall, now the champion of what some were calling the true NPP, screamed bloody murder against the betrayers of the American Revolution. The force of nationalist supporters led by none other than George Wallace yelled back into the enraged masses, offering what opposition they could amidst their police-protected picket. All across the country, smaller yet equally ferocious clashes broke out between those who shared in the marchers' woes and those who approved of the new order. American fought American, neighbor fought neighbor, fire raged up and down the land as police desperately sought to regain control. All across the nation, it reopened the wounds of American strife and began to foster and rot. And at last, the true cracks in Americans' hearts were exposed. Decreased security, decreased political parties, lose one spent stability. No, not my negative 25 political power. What am I going to do without it? We're really in a rich get richer situation. You know what we can do? Actually, first, we're going to, see what political power we need for Central Asia. A visit from Gerrymander. The analysts had carefully pored over the census data, analyzed the voting records, thoroughly considered the historical trends and social economic factors contributing to local politics. When all was said and done, they got to drafting. Every inked line, every boundary, every population point was all a part of an integrally calculated procedure. When the models had been brought to a reasonable degree of perfection, they were presented to the state legislators, who signed a new district border boundaries into law with nary another word. Only by the next morning did anyone realize the deviousness of what actually transpired. An independent analyst recognized the data, the population spread, the voting intentions, and balked at the new voting districts across the South and various other states under the NPP's domain. Each one had been painstakingly constructed to minimize the RDC vote share and maximize that of the NPP. Short of an unparalleled seismic shift in American politics, the affected states would be guaranteed NPP fiefdoms for the next decade or two at the least. Throughout the affected states, the newly disenfranchised voters marched en masse. Many of the marchers were black, but now they were also joined by a contingent of white Democrat voters who shared in their disgust at the blatant manipulation. The marches were bitter and marred with clashes against those who were considered the new order most beneficial. But many of them were able to make their voices heard. Many were locals, many were just passing through. Some were from the fringes of the old progressives, now emerging into the mainstream to seize the momentum against the damnable elite. In Washington, President Thurman and his chief advisors raised the glass and cheered to the continued stability of the National Progressive Pact. More political power loss, more stability loss, war support loss. Black voters become more Democratic and Marxist. Hispanic, more, so basically, okay, urban voters, nativist voters and rural voters become more nationalist and sovereignist. So the South is going to become way more nationalist. I don't know if this will actually update at any point. Because I don't know if the gerrymandering actually affects that at all. But we'll see. We'll see. We're almost on this tree. We are almost done. We've done what we must. 50 political power. I'm assuming there might be an event linked to this, but I can't really tell. Okay, stellar NPP campaign. Let's go run in Alabama. Middling campaign for the RDC. Not a huge surprise there. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Okay, World War II infrastructure. It's about time that America really figured that one out, huh? But these are pretty fast. 100 days. Very, very, very cheap. Foreign policy, contribute to the Iberian IAS. Oh, this is anarchy. Oh, okay. I didn't realize that. So what can we do? Is there anything we can actually do about this? Because you are all at war with each other. global conflicts, something that we can get involved in. Because I know Germany was able to get involved in this in some way. Maybe we can do something later. Or maybe that's just not America's interest. I mean, we own Iran. Iran is an ally of ours. We do border that region. Military district. Oh, they're pro-Japanese. That's fine. It's not a big deal. Okay, the eternal majority. Let's go with unity above all. I guess we can get the Marxists are down. They're already at 10%. Holy shit! But okay, what I was saying is we can do unity above all. And then we can go for good behavior. They have not, and then do we've done what we must, and then after that, we can finish up the Il Duce's disaster. As he prepared to make his closing remarks, Thurman felt a strange peace wash over him. Amidst the thunderous applause in his faction, amidst the deafening silence of the aggressives, amidst the condemnation of the Republican Democrats and the roaring chants of the protesters outside, all faded to silence as he began to speak. My fellow Americans, I have not been the president you expected. I may have not been the one that you wanted, but I am proud to call myself the president America needed. Who did what was necessary to prevent radical elements from steering our nation onto the path of certain socialist decay? He paused as the applause from his fellow men in the Nationalists drowned out all else. He briefly turned to the side, watched as every remaining progressive representative stood in unison and moved silently to the exit, pointedly avoiding his gaze, to join the radicals outside, no doubt. We had taken all the necessary steps to ensure the political stability of the nation is maintained, that our nation is never again led astray by the short-sighted idealism and ignorance. Our eternal majority over the South shall be the bulwark, ensuring that the mistakes of the Kennedy presidency are never repeated. Hear me out now. Segregation is the American tradition, and those who would seek to trample on our flag with the mixing of races and false equality should never again rise to challenge it. Thurman's heart beat furiously as the Nationalists rose to salute and cheer him. But even now, at the cusp of his final victory, he felt a pain of unease. The chanting on the the massive crowd outside yet echoed across Washington. It thundered across New York, Boston, Charlottetown. It roared across Nashville and Birmingham, Jackson, Atlanta, and Los Angeles and Baltimore, and countless cities from sea to shining sea. America was on fire. President Strom Thurman had achieved everything that he set out to do. Whether his victory would endure was more uncertain. Whether America would survive its unscathing was less certain still. Okay, so the people don't like the progressives as much. Again, the Nationalists are... I'm going to keep harping on this. Is there any state in the South where the Nationalists are more popular than the progressives? No. Yes, barely in Georgia. No. Yes. Okay, so I think they've gotten more popular now with Thurmans. But even then, it's like an equal split between the progressives and the Nationalists. Like... Everyone loved Kennedy. If Kennedy could have run for a third term, he would have done it easily. At least that's the way I see it. Operational success. Iberia! I want you on my side, my good friend. He might never do it. Which is a real shame. But I would love it. If they would be my friends. They have 5 more days on you. I guess, good behavior. They have not. And then go straight into, we've done what we've done. Center shall not hold. Presumably, that would make the Marxists even more popular. So, again, who's going to be the nominee? Who's going to be the nominee for the 72 election? Okay. The 1972 Republican-Democratic primaries. The primaries and caucuses are over, and now over 1,000 delegates from every state and territory of the Union have convened in Miami Beach Convention Center in the Edmonds City in Florida. This year, the fight has boiled down to a two-horse race between former governor of Michigan, George Romney, and Oklahoma Congresswoman Jean Kirkpatrick. Romney, whose historic bipartisanship and progressive yet business-oriented mindset represents the more mainstream opinion of the RDC as the moderate Republican, while Kirkpatrick is a staunchly liberal Democrat, whose years of experience in shaping both political science fields and foreign policy within the United States brings many questions for the RDC voters. Kirkpatrick claims that she can take some the votes from the MPP's progressive wing with her liberal yet America-first intentions, forging a new coalition that can expand America's progressive future. While Romney supporters are claiming that Kirkpatrick is nothing but a professor on a book tour who will hand another victory to the MPP. However, question between both the opinions abound. If Kirkpatrick too is disconnected from the American public to hold the RDC together, is Romney's bipartisanship boon or a hindrance? Many Republican Democrats are expressing dismay that there are only that that these are the only viable options during this time. So again, who's more popular? Democrats, right? Prediction: they're actually going to go up to 29. It's a pretty even split. But you know what? Here's how I'm going to take it. We have not heard a single event about George Romney. We've gotten several about Jean Kirkpatrick. So I think it makes sense to throw her in here. 800 political power. What the fuck am I going to do with this? What do you want me to spend this on, my friends? Invest in Nova Cerberisk. No. Let's destabilize Japan just for the fun of it. Again, Russia is still fighting their war. Yeah, I think they're actually going to kill Finland, which is crazy. The Jim Crow's eulogy. Before we actually read this, let's just get you going. As the day of National Progressive PAC's first party caucus since the death of President Kennedy approached, many wondered, some nervously, some gleefully, what the agenda on the day would be like. Most were certain that Thurmond would speak in regards to the Civil Rights Act, a call to end its enforcement at least, if not outright revoke. It was almost an assured point to of call expected from the president. And when he took the podium to speak to the assembled politicians, he didn't need to open with talks on that fated matter. Yet, nobody present expected what he was about to say. Admitting that he had long desired to revoke the act, calling it a sledgehammer trying to fix a splinter, Thurmond conceded to the concerned forces of the progressives and the bewildered nationalists that he could not allow himself to touch President Kennedy's most prestigious achievement. In the interest of party unity, in the memory of President Kennedy, and in the name of bringing stability back to America, Thurmond vowed that he would leave the act in place. His speech concluded to the relieved applause of progressives and the stunned silence of many on the right. After a long day of discussions on the party's conduct and the other rather construction matters, in which Thurmond won many of the nationalists back with various promises to push forward some of their other agendas, the pact emerged from the meeting more unified than they had been in a long time. Though the right and Thurmond himself quietly commemorated over the finality of the civil rights, they accepted that the party and nation brought together was far more important than an unrepentant reaction. Okay. And I will say with that, it's going to be a good time for us to end this episode. So if you enjoy my thumbs up, then I'll enjoy your thumbs down. You want to see more, subscribe, and goodbye.